So I'm just going to let, and I'm not going to put anybody on the spot. Nobody has to say anything. This is not church, and this is not school, and I will not grade you until I'll talk about you when I leave, but I won't grade you. Unless you want me to. I think it'll reach you. Does anybody have a story of 9/11 that they want to say? Even the blue sky. Is there anybody who wants to know about that? Or does anybody want to know about what these things mean? I can tell you at the beginning. What do we do? Do that. Is it that? Oh, it could be Dan.
Can you plug it in anymore?
Is it plugged in? Oh, no, it wasn't plugged in. That's perfect. This was very difficult to stretch. I'll tell you a funny story. I had lots of funny stories about this thing. But it took five people to stretch this canvas. It is 18 feet. It's at the limit of commercially preparing. I was going to make this 24 feet, and I'm sorry that anybody would hate me because they couldn't show the damn plate over there. But it was such a big, monumental task to stretch it. Okay, this is part of empathy. Because it took five people, three tries to stretch it. It took three stretcher bars, systems of stretcher bars to do it. In other words, that's what supports this. This is on canvas. One that I got stretched and it started to bow. And I started cursing the world. The second time it didn't fit. And the third time I finally got that thing to work. Unbelievable. I mean, you see, this starts to write my story. This is my palimpsest of memories. This starts to write the friends, you know, of who helped me. They were important. They're woven into my story in 9/11. Because I remember telling them, come on, I'll take you out for a beer afterwards. You just have to do it. And I had stretchy bars and it was whipping and all kinds of things. And it's the sky on this lovely frame. The war path is described. And then I had to do what's called, I had to get all the models in. And this model here was this Adam. He's from Amherst, Massachusetts. Adam was a wonderful little kid. And he posed, I built this out of cardboard first. This was a replica. Planks. And the reason I made them toys, they're like overburdensome toys, a little confusing to people, but there were two things that happened. When I heard about the towers falling, I was in listening to the radio, and they said, well, a plane has hit the towers, and I thought, well, it's probably just a plot plane. Someone was out, you know, it was the Kennedys or whatever was going on, and there was something crazy going on, probably a Texan, in a plane that hit the towers. And I'm laughing, but then you think it was not towers, it was a jet. But the innocuous thing is nothing like this had ever happened before. We had taken planes to Disney World. People had hijacked planes from people going to Disney World. That was the worst thing that happened. But most of the time, it was a wonderful thing. Like, I was going to get in a plane to come and see people up here. And so the idea of this sort of, this thing was so wonderful, this tool of pleasure that can be used as a weapon. And it was just an interesting, not interesting, but a tragic idea. So I wanted thesis to be burdensome, but also give the idea of innocence. Also give the idea, which is in Western painting, often martyrs will have the implements of their martyrdom slightly over life size, like the cap or the wheel. But anyway, back to Adam as a funny god, because I begged the parents to do it, and he had this wonderful sort of hair and everything that reminded me of Quattrocento painted, and Adam sat there, and he had little things, and I had piles of sand all over the floor, and Adam just decided he was going to play in sand. He gets down and plays in sand, and, you know, and he's got a cupcake, and a sand-looking cupcake, and everything, so it's sort of pallying him, so he would pose for this serene painting. I met Adam Gull, not the cupcake guy, and I took all the sand away, and I put yellow fabric there. And so the next time he comes, he looks at me and he goes, I know why you did that. You didn't want me to play in the sand. And I thought that was really interesting. And again, this writes a meaning into this, because this is a living person. It's an archetype. In classical painting, there's ideas. They always try to balance in different styles of painting something called the noumenon, which is kind of the essence, the phenomenon, which is a particular. And in Reynolds, we always talk about painting the archetype. You want that to be, not only is it going to be a dog, it's going to be the emblem of a dog. It has to feel dog in essence, and not just dog in specific. So in this classic art, we want to give a specific type, but we we also want to do an a specific type, which is Adam, but also an ideal, which is, it represents something serene. It's innocence in this case. I had people, this was actually the daughter of a friend whose mothers were the first people to get married in Massachusetts as women. So that brought it into my memory. She was a friend of somebody, a friend of my best friend from France, who's the daughter of his girlfriend. This here was a friend as well. He's posing, again, his archetype is to represent all the fallen figures. Remember, there were people that jumped. And I took things, another thing you do with the art is you know, it's great, great literature. You think about Moby Dick and Dante and people who can quote from other people. It's just a great tradition where you could take a little bit of that of everything. And in great painting, you can quote other people. It's just, especially classical painting. I mean, some creators might just hate this and they probably say, well, I'm looking at great YouTube, I just hate it. But I can do this because I'm free to take sources from other history. This was taken from Picasso's Guernica. And I wanted to then, in my ideas of how I'm writing things, I wanted to rewrite Picasso into this because he was very important in the 20th century. And I was uneasy with Guernica. Some people have told me they're uneasy about this painting. It wasn't beautiful, but it was horrific. And I wanted that to bring something to that. And then I met this man on the street. I said, this is just exactly who I am. He looked like somebody who embodied not only classical ideal of him, and Masaccio, who was at a sort of martyrdom of Jesus, or St. John the Baptist by Rodin, walking forward. He was the person I wanted, and he had a slightly Arabic quality to him. And I wanted that to be written into this history, because I think we really worry about, you know, people who come here from different places and whether they're accepted. And what he's doing in classical painting and early ideas, they let a lot of the story be told with hand gestures. Acting there in the 19th century would tell you how to act, and they said, well, you'd have to put your hand this way, and if you touched your head, that was mental, and if you touched your eye, that was emotional, and if you touched your mouth, that was physical. And so each hand would be described and perfect. And I thought, well, what would you do if you were denying something? If something's tragic, you don't want to happen. And so I took these martyrdom images, and the pose is a lot like an airplane, if you notice these, the shape. So instead of being a martyr like this, Christ, he would be sort of martyred like this. And he'd have to deny something because tragedy is denial. I mean, we don't want that to happen. It's horrible. And then, but the second thing is that that's denial, first is denial, then tragedy is something that we sort of open up to, because we have no choice. So the pose here is somewhat of an acceptance of what happened. And it's moving down. I mean, this part of what when I was at Amherst College, papers on continued narrative painting. So this painting, in one way, can be read from left to right, in the ages of man, but blind to the future, terror, and tragedy, acceptance, and then what happens after that. And these figures were sort of, I took them from fate, the three fates, and sort of woven together in history, which is something we can look back. But the continued narrative here starts where these two figures, my friends, are leading their way to this, where there's a choice. At least on this side of the timeline, there's a choice. When you get to here, there's no choice. And these are these figures growing up. They're handcuffed together not because they've been in prison, but simply because they can't get away from each other. Moreover, it sort of suggests the bonds of people aftermath. If you think about the communities that were devastated by 9/11, they were really often, a lot of people, they had their husbands are working at, say, Cantor Fitzgerald, and it was the women that were there to raise their kids, and they had this sense of community. I mean, I talked to people afterwards. The three things are the candle, which you saw after, which is light, of course, but it's also an idea of vanitas. This right here was used in the play. You could see people running through the streets after 9/11, holding a mask of dust, and then screaming, because what can you do? I mean, other than there's nothing, you're stuck, you're mourning, you're calling for people who may have survived. I think that's what this did, and also the rhythm of something, and the references again to Transfiguration, which is from the Sistine Chapel, just a slight over.